Good morning and welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to all who come to worship on this Lord's Day. We pray that our service of worship will be a blessing to you. Before we move forward in our worship service, we have a few announcements. Please join us this Monday night for Monday Night Church at 6 o'clock on Zoom. We've been discussing a book called Canoeing the Mountains about leadership and adapting to change amongst us. So please come join us at 6 o'clock on Zoom. Also, this Wednesday, we'll be resuming our men's breakfast at 7 a.m. Although we will be missing Morris's cinnamon rolls, I invite you all to come join me for fellowship and devotion as we come together. This Saturday, the Mobile Food Ministry will be handing out food to those who are in need at noon down in the lower parking lot. The flowers this morning are given to the glory of God and in memory of Myra and Thomas Crow by Edna Carroll and Elba Barnes. Friends, let us worship God together. Please join me in the call to worship. Each one of us here in this moment of worship is different.
We are unique individuals.
We come from various backgrounds.
We come with differing needs and dreams.
Yet the Lord calls us to worship in grace-filled unity.
Praise be to God who blesses our diversity and our unity.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose compassion embraces everyone, gather the outcast and the lost, heal the wounds of fear and distrust, and make us a community of reconciliation, that we may embody your merciful love and rejoice in your astounding grace. We pray this through Jesus Christ, whose blessings know no boundaries that faith cannot cross. Amen.
Our fears.
We may praise God, but we prefer to live our way, becoming captive to our selfish wants and ways of looking at the world. But God longs to set us free, so let us confess our sins without fear to the one who yearns to embrace us, forgive us, protect us, and bless us. Please join me in our prayer of confession. God of this day, we have opportunities to live out of your love, but we so often choose not to follow you. From our hearts to our mouths flow words that hurt others, come thoughts that lead us away from you. We are richly blessed, but think others should be grateful for the crumbs we offer to them. Our claims to have great faith are disputed by our inability to trust you in all things. We come to you, helper of the weak, for you are gracious and forgiving. You offer us the fullness of your love, not just a few crumbs. You refuse to let us go and sweep us up with arms of joy. Help us to love as you have loved us, that our lives may testify to your abounding grace through Jesus Christ. Amen. I ask you, has God rejected us?
No. By God's grace, God's gifts, and God's calling are never taken back.
I ask you, has God rejected your neighbor?
No. That love we know as God reaches out to all.
This is good news, dear friends. Believe in it.
Thanks be to God. We are forgiven. Amen.
Since God in Christ has forgiven us, let us also forgive one another. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
In this coming time for children, please use this time to pass the peace with one another.
Have you ever forgotten to wash your hands before you ate? I think probably all of us have forgotten like once in our life. And that's okay. But it's really important for us to do that. It's really important for us to have clean hands before we eat. But in chapter 15 of Matthew, starting in verse 10, Jesus tells us that there is something that's even more important. During Jesus' life, many people followed strict rules about what they could and couldn't eat. And that was because they believed that God didn't want them to eat certain things. But in today's gospel lesson, we hear that Jesus tells people that it's not really what goes into our mouths that matter, it's what comes out of our mouth. One day, some of the religious leaders were asking Jesus why his disciples weren't washing their hands before they ate. I guess they forgot, just like we do sometimes. And Jesus answered, he said, "What comes out of your mouth is far more important than what goes in it." He said, "The words that come out of your mouth come from your heart, and those words show whether your heart is clean or unclean, just like your hands." The things we say are important because they hold a lot of power. Has anyone ever said anything to you that made you feel proud of yourself, or happy, or important and valued? Words can do that. They can lift you up. And just like other people's words can make you feel that way, your words can also lift people up. If you tell somebody something that makes them feel proud of themselves, that lifts them up. You can make other people feel happy and important and valued just by the words that you speak. But maybe you can also think of a time where words have hurt your feelings. I'm sure you've heard the saying, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me." Which sounds nice, but isn't necessarily true. Words are hurtful. We can all remember a time where something someone has said has hurt your feelings, or maybe a time where you've said something to someone that has hurt their feelings. So why don't we use our words to lift people up? Why don't we say positive and encouraging things to everyone that we meet? God hears everything that we say, and he knows the thoughts that we have in our heart. So it is very important for us to be careful about the things that we say and think, because hateful words come from an unclean heart. So for this week, as we're returning back to school and work and seeing all of our friends again, I encourage you to use your words for the good, for the positive, lift other people up. Think about your words carefully and use opportunities to make people feel better, smarter, happier, and more loved than they did before you first spoke. Will you do that? As you go back to school, think about how your words affect other people. Think about how you can lift someone up, because by lifting others up, you also lift God up. So let's close our lesson in prayer. Close your eyes and bow your heads. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day and the blessings you have given us. As we go back to school and as we go out into the world, help us to remember to use our words to lift people up, Lord, to lift you up. Thank you for keeping us safe and watching over us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Lord, the noise all around us is loud and frightening. We find ourselves anxious and distracted, worried about much we cannot control. We long to hear you tell us to not be afraid. We ask again for the gift of your peace that passes understanding. As the word is read and proclaimed, send your Holy Spirit to help us rightly hear and respond. Amen. I invite you to listen to the word of the Lord. Our gospel reading is Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the last sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the word of the Lord.
Every time I have encountered this text, it excites with me curiosity and fear. It cuts through the hallmark responses we are so often given to our lives and our faith questions, and instead meets us on a personal level, where we come face to face with our daily struggle of living faithfully. Jesus calls this woman who comes to him, pleading for her child to be healed, a dog. A dog. Let that sink in for a moment. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, the bringer of truth, the feeder of the 5,000, the storyteller of the Good Samaritan, the one who eats with sinners and reaches out to lepers, refers to this woman as someone in our context might refer to another by using the harsh language of calling them a female dog. Each time I come across this text, I am stunned. I am confused on how or why Jesus, the person I am to model my faith and develop my relationship with God, would treat someone so rude and frankly, cold-hearted. This passage stirs in me emotions and thoughts of disagreeing with Jesus, questioning my beliefs, and absolutely challenging my faith. Because this is not the Jesus I was taught in Sunday school class, or any class for that matter. Jesus is God, and God is sovereign, loving, full of grace, and abounded with mercy. Yet here we seem to find Jesus not so full of grace, not particularly loving thy neighbor, nor merciful to those in need. How do we reconcile this in our faith, in our lives? Matthew's account begins with Jesus and his disciples traveling through the Gentile region of Tyre and Sidon, a place where Jesus is now the outsider. Jesus is in a place the Canaanites as many of you will remember, have viciously fought back and forth with the Israelites for centuries over land, faith, and simple bigotry. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands of lives have been lost to these two people's encounters with one another. Although according to the Hebrew scriptures, the Canaanites were all killed centuries before Jesus, the word Canaanite itself was sometimes used to depict the enemy of Israel. Needless to say, at the time Jesus and his disciples entered this land, the two ethnicities, these two religions, the two heritages, the two cultures did not like each other very much. So much they were known for open degradation and simple-minded hate. The gulf between the two was larger than Democrats and Republicans. It was larger than the animosity sometimes between Christians and Muslims. It even held deeper roots than racism between blacks and whites. So when this Canaanite woman begins yelling at Jesus, which breaks all acceptable social standards, the disciples are not just annoyed by one more person coming and asking for healing. They are downright disgusted. By what right does this heathen God worshiper, who is the epitome of what we stand against, yell at us for help? Our translation in the NRSV fails to truly capture the moment. The Greek that Matthew uses here is the imperfect form of the verb. This implies she does not cry out once, but repeatedly cries out over and over and over again, "Have mercy on me, Lord! Have mercy on me, Lord! Son of David, my daughter is tormented by demons. Have mercy on her. Have mercy on me. Oh Lord, please bring healing." Over and over and over, she yells at them. She pleads with them, "Help. Help me. Help my daughter. Please, Lord, have mercy." But as any pious and good Israelite does, Jesus keeps walking in silence, and his disciples encourage him to send her away. Finally, Jesus breaks his silence by not speaking with a Canaanite woman, oh no, but instead to his disciples to say, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." After hearing this, the Canaanite woman, she dropped to her knees and begged with all her soul, "Lord, help me." This is a plea that I have echoed since I understood the meaning. This is a plea that we have all shared throughout times of fear and darkness in our lives. This is a plea that we profess in our confessions and in the core of our faith, that God will hear. "Please, Lord, help me." This is what we expect for God to hear us in our cries of weakness and in our hope for God to answer. The Canaanite woman did indeed receive her answer. Jesus said to her, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." I can think of many times in my life when I have begged and pleaded with God to help, crying out, "Lord, please help me." I can't help but think about today. How many in this world, in our country, in our communities, cry out, "Lord, please help." How many are crying out right now for food? How many are crying out right now for a safe place to sleep? How many are crying out for a job so they can care for their families? How many are crying out for an end to violence? Crying out for a pandemic to relent, crying out for the solitude to be filled with a loving embrace, crying out for justice for all of God's children to come. Lord God, please help. Over and over, Lord, please help. Maybe you're like me, and sometimes wonder over the years if I'm not one of those dogs, one of those unworthy to receive Jesus' mercy. When I watch the news or listen to people in our community and view the suffering of so many people, I wonder where those prayers are going. God, do you hear us? In our Psalms, you tell us, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love and great power to redeem. Well, where is it? As we cry out over and over and over, Lord, where is this great power to redeem? After Jesus said to her, it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs, she replied to Jesus, yes, Lord. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. This response by a person of a different faith than that of my own, this response by a person who has been ridiculed and mocked, is one of the most astonishing and most profound statements I have read. Because throughout this whole encounter, she has called Jesus Lord. Because throughout this whole encounter, she has held Jesus as the Son of David, the Messiah. Because throughout this whole encounter, she has more faith in a foreign God than I have had in my own. As her child lay possessed by a demon and herself ridiculed and ignored, she holds on to faith. I pray that one day I will exhibit faith that breaks barriers and allows me to wait upon the Lord. By Jesus being present in a dangerous place, encountering someone outside of his nationality, his ethnicity, someone wholly other to him, his perception of the world was challenged by a continued faithfulness of another that led to an uncomfortable transformation. Although this woman was a child of God that proclaimed Jesus as Lord, the disciples wanted nothing to do with her. Even Jesus ignored her. But through her persistent protest, her ongoing presence and unwillingness to give up on her hope and live out her faith, healing followed. In the wake of so much ugliness, pain, and division in our world, we too can choose to be like the disciples, pushing people away from Christ when they don't look like us or believe like us. Or we can continually turn to God and turn to one another in faith, assured God's healing will happen. So often we try and fail to be like Jesus, but maybe what we need to learn from Matthew in this passage is to have faith. Live out of that faith every minute, praying to God and caring for one another, no matter how different they might be. To be like someone that has been ridiculed and put down. To be a person that has enough faith to plead to God no matter how bad things might look. Friends, it is not easy living the way God calls us to. God doesn't just call us to proclaim our faith inside our sanctuaries, to write scripture on Facebook, to be faithful like this Canaanite woman, is to break barriers, is to fall down upon our knees in the face of danger and call out to God. Our country is in a place that is being ravaged by a pandemic. People are starving in confusion, bigotry, and hate abound more than I'd like to admit. But as people of faith, we have an opportunity. No, we have more than an opportunity. We have a duty as followers of Christ to go to those dangerous places, to meet with those who are different than us, whether it's differences in ideology and politics, ethnicity, or race, to cry out to them in faith, in hope, in love, to break barriers, not through ridiculing, but in pleas for help and healing. So let us now, let us call out to others in hope. Let us call out to God for healing, and let us be present with one another, sharing our faith, knowing boundaries can be broken. Friends, this is the gospel, and this is the good news of God. So thanks be to God, and let us be the people of God. Amen. It is in this faith, it is in this gospel hope, that we proclaim what we believe. I invite you to join me in our affirmation of faith. God, the Holy Spirit, fulfills the work of reconciliation in human life. The Holy Spirit creates and renews the church as a community in which people are reconciled to God and to one another. The Spirit enables people to receive forgiveness as they forgive one another, and to enjoy the peace of God as they make peace among themselves. In spite of their sin, the Spirit gives people power to become representatives of Jesus Christ and His gospel of reconciliation to all. Christ has provided for us from His own table of blessings. God's abundance overflows. Let us offer our gifts together from the bounty God has given.
Thank you.
Please join me in prayer. May we not offer you the leftovers of our resources and our lives, blessing God, but let these gifts be but part of what we give back to you as we seek to serve your people and your creation, good and gracious God. So many of your people are hurting. There seems no end in sight to the uncertainty and pain of this season. Parents and caregivers are worried about children's well-being as the school year approaches and this pandemic persists. Those living in group care facilities yearn to be able to have visitors again, and the loneliness of those already isolated grows. The economic fallout from this virus gets deeper and wider as many scramble to find work and put food on the table. It feels at times as if we call out to you and you do not respond. Like the Canaanite woman, we shout for mercy, but we receive no help. Yet she kept calling out to you, kept following you, refused to be turned away until you healed her daughter. We call out to you now, Lord Christ, have mercy on us. Hear our cries. Help us. We call out for mercy for those on the front lines of fighting for justice. We call out for mercy for those on the front lines of fighting this pandemic. We call out for mercy for those grieving for the death of loved ones. We call out for mercy for the sick and those who tend them. We call out for mercy for the scared and those who comfort them. We call out for mercy for those without food or housing, medical care, or community. We call out for mercy on behalf of those who do not have the strength to raise their own voices. We call out for mercy for ourselves, trusting you, and that you know our deepest needs, even if we do not have the wisdom to name them. Hear us, Lord. Heal us, Lord. Help us, Lord. For we pray this through Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Church is story, bring its God to glory.
Now go to serve as God's people.
We will work to remove all that divides us from others.
Now go to share the grace of Jesus Christ.
We will love others just as we are loved.
Now go to be the Spirit community.
We will invite everyone to join us in this life of faith and service.
May the God of compassion, the Christ that breaks boundaries, and the Spirit of unity be with you now and always. Amen.
Let us build a house where love is.